Hello, I'm Annette Young and welcome to The 51%, a show about women reshaping our world. Now, for the last 2 years, we have watched the African nation of Sudan begin its journey towards democracy. However, transitioning from authoritarian rule to democracy inevitably has had its difficulties, with many in the country, especially women's activists, fearing that progress has been far too slow. Alaa Salah gained internet fame after images of her leading protest chants against the then President Omar al-Bashir went viral. She's now a committed women's rights activist and, I'm delighted to say, joins me in the studio today. We'll be talking shortly, but first, Sanam Shantier reports on the courageous woman behind the image.
This was the image that propelled Alaa Salah to fame, standing atop a car in a white thobe, reciting a revolutionary poem. The 22-year-old also became a symbol of the push for reform in her country, Sudan, earning the nicknames Lady Liberty and the Woman in White.
The moment I climbed on top of that car, I started to recite a poem. The bullet doesn't kill. What kills is a silence of people. And people react to this poem because it's a very accurate description of what's happening on the streets of Sudan.
It was in 2019 that Salah took part in protests against the nearly three-decade rule of dictator Omar al-Bashir. At the time, she was an architectural engineering student with little interest in politics. But she decided to fight for change, putting a new perspective on the role of women in shaping the future of the region. She was one of many women who was leading resistance committees and helping to plan sit-ins and demonstrations, often risking tear gas, assault, and prison for their actions. Since 2019, the country has been ruled by a power-sharing civilian-military entity. But Salah hasn't stopped calling for change. She's now fighting for equal representation in government so that women are not sidelined as Sudan takes the next steps towards its future.
And watching that report with me is Alaa Salah, whose journey has been detailed in this book in French, which has just been published. Alaa, thank you so much for coming in and talking to us. What a journey you've been on. But let me start by saying I imagine there are not too many architectural engineering students in Sudan to begin with. So what made you decide to basically be trained as one?
In fact, there are many women studying architectural engineering. It's not limited to men. We have noticed over the last few years that the presence of girls in the engineering field in general is almost more than boys. Women in Sudan are present in so many fields, be it as students or as workers. They are visible. During the Sudanese revolution, 60% of protesters were women. They were on the front lines too. They also played an important role in our revolution. And this shows how strong and how present women are in Sudan.
Alaa, I have to ask you, do you call yourself a feminist?
Not at all. At the beginning, I participated in the revolution, and then I moved on to defending human rights. This is because in Sudan, we do lack the very basic human rights. So what I defend, the cause I believe in, and what I would like to work on is, first of all, education, because it's a fundamental question. There are great women working on the feminist issues, but for me, I want to focus more on education.
But Alaa, you live in a very traditional Muslim society, so you must have experienced pushback from certain quarters, because in your country, it's not really a norm for women to speak out. So what did your father say, for instance?
Well, I realise I am very lucky. My family supports me a lot, especially my father. He's always been a great support to me. I still remember when I first went to school and then later onto the university. All along the way, he told me that At every new stage in my life, in different areas of society, I would be confronted with different situations. He said, if you ever feel there's injustice, say no, even if you're not involved, because we don't have to turn a blind eye when it comes to injustice. So this is what I remember to give me the strength to carry on, that I have full support from my family.
Tell me about the days leading up to those protests, Alaa. What was the mood like at your university, at home?
Over the last few years, the situation in Sudan has been getting worse day by day. We've had to weather many crises in the economy, in education, in the health system. People died for want of basic equipment, such as oxygen in hospitals, for example. We also had tough economic times, gas and fuel shortages, no bread. Sometimes we had to line up for hours to get cash from the bank so we could go and line up again to get our basic needs for the day.
What made you decide to get on top of that vehicle?
Well, as we saw in your report, there was a very good-natured spirit that day. Protesters were chanting slogans very enthusiastically, and all the groups were chanting together. So I didn't decide especially to get on that vehicle. I just found myself there. It wasn't supposed to be a place to get up on, for example. And I kept wondering, when will I finish my speech? And with all that energy in the crowd from the protesters, how am I going to get down?
What did you feel at the time?
Chants and slogans were our way of coming together, of sharing our hopes and dreams. And it was the same feeling for all of us. It's what drove us to protest. We came from different cultures, from different regions. We had different mentalities, we were different ages. And maybe in this place, we found out to what extent we were the same. Every person felt that he or she was in Plato's ideal city, as we all took part in a massive sit-in. There was a range of feelings. Fervor, hope, desire, many emotions in one. But the main feeling was the shared involvement and a shared cause.
Several years on, and there's been much anger that there has not been a lot of progress made, particularly when it comes to the status of women. There have been protests in the last month or so where women's activists have taken to the streets calling for a prosecution system to deal with gender violence. Are you frustrated by the lack of progress?
Since the day after the revolution, when decisions and negotiations began, Sudanese women were clearly excluded. This made us angry because us women, we played an important role in the revolution. So how come that when it came to making decisions, to decide how women could take part in deciding Sudan's future, women are not part of the discussion? Many stood up against this marginalization. The new constitution guarantees 40% of political representation, but that's not enough. So we pushed to demand at least 50%. One of our slogans was, our full rights without complacency.
One of the initiatives, we said, our full rights without complacency.
Unfortunately, when the government was formed, the representation of women was less than 25%. And this stirred up our anger again. Today, women represent even less than 20%. We're not satisfied with this. So we decided to go for the next step. For us, it's no longer a matter of female representation reaching 40 or 50%. But beyond that, women should have access to decision-making positions. This is the goal we're now pushing for.
Finally, Alaa, what next for your country? What do you hope it's going to look like 30 years from now?
Well, what should be happening in Sudan is that we get on our way towards democracy, towards freedom, to build a democratic and free Sudan, the Sudan we dream of living in. We're now at a transitional stage, facing many obstacles, but we believe that the last 30 years of violations and corruption cannot be wiped out overnight. We still have a long way to go, and that is very challenging, but we can overcome this. What matters for us is to create a milestone for a new Sudan of democracy and freedom. Let me remind you of the French Revolution 2 centuries ago. Without those sacrifices and those martyrs, you would not have the democratic France that you're living in today. So it's the same for us. It's about building a country of rights, citizenship, justice, and democracy. We might not live to see that, to enjoy that, but at least future generations will be able to live in a country that respects them and guarantees them their full rights.
Alaa Salah, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you very much.
And that's it for now. You can also connect with us via our Facebook page, that of course being France24.51%, or do send us a tweet at underscore 51%. So until our next show, bye for now.